Hello, everyone. So we are going to be talking about intermittent fasting. This seems to be the rage right now, right? You go on the internet and everybody's talking about, hey, if you do intermittent fasting, you're going to start losing weight. You're going to look 10 years younger, all those things, right? So now I wanted to invite someone who is an expert on intermittent fasting, and we have Adnan. Adnan is a functional medicine coach who specializes on diet and definitely on intermittent fasting. Welcome, Adnan.
Glad to be here, Amita. Thank you so much for having me.
Yes, yes. So let's just understand, what exactly is intermittent fasting?
Intermittent fasting, you know, so, okay, you know, first I'd like to mention that, you know, for most of us, people trying to lose weight and trying to get in shape, you know, we're always looking for something new. And so intermittent fasting, like you rightfully put, that this is trending right now. So everybody's following, you know, getting on the bandwagon. And this is the need of time where we must differentiate the confusion from the fact. And so coming to your question, Amita, intermittent fasting is time-restricted eating. It is not calorie-restricted eating. And that is the main distinction, which simply means that when you're, you see, when you're doing a diet, you're cutting your calories across the board and you're eating less throughout the day, you know, because you've been told that if you eat less, you lose weight, right? Which seldom works, which maybe we'll get to later on. Intermittent fasting, on the other hand, is time-restricted eating. So there are certain times when you eat, and there are certain times, we call it the fasting window, that you don't eat. That is the main distinction. And the premise with intermittent fasting, Amita, is that you give your body a break. You see, when you don't eat for a certain extended number of hours, you give your body a break. And that's where the true benefits of intermittent fasting, they start to surface.
Sure. And we are giving our bodies a break when we sleep, right? But this is a little bit different. So let's just talk about different types of intermittent fasting, right? The again, the internet is like 24, 16, 8, right? Oh, man. Yeah. I mean, it is so confusing.
Yeah, it is. And, you know, there, you know, I keep seeing on my newsfeed, there are apps that are out there, you know, they're trying to, you know, there's, I think there was some app that was actually telling you what kind of fasting format you should do based on your fingers, you know, and it's just unbelievable because it is trending right now. So there you go. So yes, there are multiple fasting formats, but the main thing is that it has to work with your individual metabolism. So the common perception, or I should say misconception, is that people tend to think that the larger your, or the longer your fasting window, the better it is across the board. And that's not true. So in other words, people will compare a OMAD, you mentioned, which is one meal a day, being somewhat superior to a 16-hour fast, which apparently does seem to be the case. However, it could also happen that your body and your individual metabolism was working fine on a 16-hour format or even a 14-hour format, but then you, as soon as you took it to a 20-hour, things started to go in the other direction. So it is a very individual thing, and you shouldn't just go with, you know, what's trending or what seems to be fancy or what seems to be tough, because a lot of the stuff that we have learned about weight loss and getting in shape is that the harder and the tougher it is, the, somehow the better it would be. And that's not true.
So let's talk about OMAD, right? OMAD has the concept of one meal a day. And in that one meal, I've never tried it, by the way. I can't even imagine eating everything one meal, like for within a certain window, and then not eat at all. Like the whole day, kind of like, okay, looking at the food, but I'm not going there, right? So, so how does that work? Like, am I supposed to eat like 2,000 calories, like within a 2-hour window?
Yeah.
What happens?
Yeah, that's exactly what it is, Amita. That's what you're supposed to do. So whatever your eating window is, you confine your eating, your food, to that particular window. And that is exactly what I meant earlier on. You see, when you look at a fasting format as tough as one meal a day. And if you're starting off right off the bat, you jump into OMAD, you're going to get overwhelmed. Your body's going to get overwhelmed, and you certainly your metabolism is going to get overwhelmed. So once as if you decide to start intermittent fasting, and I would recommend that everybody do try it, that when you do it, then you progressively ease into it. You know, you start with something very basic, and then you slowly and gradually you start adding hours to your fasting window. That is not too difficult, because let's say if I say you've got to start fasting and you're going to start with something as basic as 6 to 8 hours of not eating. And then gradually every couple of weeks, you start adding a couple of hours. And then let's say in a span of a couple of weeks, you build up to that. That is something that is going to be acceptable to your mind and to your body.
Okay. So, and what are your thoughts on 5-2, right? Eating for 5 days and then fasting for 2 days. That's another concept that at least I have seen.
Yes. Yes. And this is another way of looking at it. In fact, that is what I propose and I advocate, that, you know, going fasting, even if it is working out for you, whatever format that you're doing, you don't want to do it straight consecutive 7 days. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, the body likes balance. So let's say you're doing intermittent fasting and your body's in the state of ketosis, which it should be. Perhaps we'll talk about that later on. So your body's running on ketones and fats as a source of fuel. Now, ideally, what you want to do is come out of that state. In order to reap the real benefits, you want to come out of ketosis and you want to give your intermittent fasting a break for a day or two or maybe three, and then you go back into fasting. So that's what this means. Because if you look at it from a different angle, what you're basically doing is you're trying to teach your body to be metabolically flexible. And I want to put that in inverted commas, because you see, when your body is primed to be in fasting and perform fine, and then come out of fasting and perform fine still, that means you've achieved a state of metabolic flexibility.
Hmm. Okay. Explain us a little bit on the ketones and the metabolic flexibility.
Yeah. Okay. So what happens is, you see, when for the majority of us humans, we are running on glucose metabolism, which is our brain and our bodies are running on glucose, which is the end form of carbohydrates and proteins. You see, whenever we eat something, it is broken down into glucose, which is the end form, and utilized as energy, right? So whatever is in excess at that point gets stored as fats, right? So what ketosis is, or what metabolic flexibility is, that we are teaching our body, are teaching our metabolism to use fats as a fuel source. So it's like you're driving a hybrid car technology, you know? So it's running on fuel, but then it also is equipped with, you know, running on water or electricity, you know? And that's where it becomes efficient, because there's no green, there's no carbon footprint. There's no carbon dioxide emissions, you know? And that's what this is. So what happens, ideally what should happen in intermittent fasting is that your body should be able to run on both fuels. But for most people, because they have not achieved that state of being in ketosis, that's where the problem happens. Because let's say if your body's not primed to use fats as a fuel source, then your body starts to crash. Let's say today you decide that, you know, I'm so fascinated with fasting, I'm going to do the 16-8 format. But because you didn't do the homework and you didn't, quote unquote, prime your metabolism, you did not do the stuff that is needed, your body starts to crash, which is what happens with most people. So I say the one main prerequisite of fasting successfully is to create a state of metabolic flexibility.
And they should we should all seek out someone to coach us, not necessarily, because it's very hard to sustain, right? I mean, yeah, so let's say we start at 16-8, so that means 8 hours we don't eat anything, and then in 16 hours we're supposed to eat. The 16 hours now that we have, we're supposed to eat, Is there a certain set of format that we need to follow in the 16 hours?
Yeah. Okay, so what happens is, let's say you're doing a 16-8, so your fasting window is 16 hours. Your eating window is 8 hours.
Oh, eating window is 8 hours. Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So what happens is, now I advocate mostly an overnight fast. So let's say you sleep at 10 p.m., mm-hmm. right? Now, 10 a.m. makes 12 hours, and you've just got to add another 4 hours on top. So that is why overnight fasting, you know, it gives you that ease, you know, so to speak, that, you know, it gives you that time that you've already sleeping, your body's already doing the good stuff because you're not eating, and then you're adding a few hours on top. And so you have this 8 hour window. Let's say if you're doing a 16 hour fast and you sleep at 10, so your eating window begins at 2? Yeah, 2 p.m. So from 2 to 10, the 8 hours, that is where you're supposed to eat. So you're supposed to confine your eating between 2 p.m. and 10 p.m.
Got it. And what about the drinks? Like, can you have water during the fasting period?
Yes, absolutely. You see, there are certain fasting hacks that you should do, because for most people, when they're fasting and their energy is zapped, that's because of an electrolyte imbalance. So what I give my clients, and it works fantastically, is that you drink lots of water with pink salt, because electrolytes, you see, when the body is not getting enough electrolytes, you start getting, you know, headaches, your energy is zapped. So you want to have, you know, lemon water with a pinch of pink salt. And I also have them add, let's say 1/4 or a half cup of unsweetened coconut water, which gives you the potassium, which is also part of the electrolytes, right? Mm-hmm. So that way you can keep drinking water. It's alkaline in nature. It's really healthy, and it helps you go through your fasting window. That's one of the hacks. The other thing that you could also add into your diet is MCT, which is medium chain triglycerides. It's MCT oil. So what you basically do is you add it to your coffee, right? Mm-hmm. And then you sip away. So it's basically tasteless. And it's something that you can, you know, I mean, you wouldn't even feel. If you're a coffee drinker, you add a couple of teaspoons into your coffee and you're fine. You know, and that helps you promote a state of ketosis. That's what it does.
Got it. Yeah. No, understand. So now there's also concept of, let's say, a lot of cultures, right? I mean, I come from India and we grew up with fasting culture, right? During this certain time of the actually week, or even during Ramadan, right? You know, my dad used to be in Algeria, so I grew up there quite a bit. So 1 month of fasting. What are your thoughts on these cultures? They already have fasting built in, and now we're inventing all these interesting terms now, right?
Yes, absolutely. And I guess, I believe fasting has been around for centuries, and it has been part of almost every religion, you know, from Muslims to Christianity to Hinduism. And it just shows that, you know, if you backtrack all the religions, they're all advocating not eating for a certain period of time.
Yes.
So it makes all the more sense that, you know, the benefits, when you start researching the benefits of intermittent fasting, it's just unbelievable. You know, I can give you my story. When I started intermittent fasting, I was a pre-diabetic. We call that insulin resistant. You know, my insulin was high, my blood sugar was high, and I couldn't go, you know, just even a few hours without eating. If I wouldn't eat for a few hours, I'd start to get jittery. You know, my mental clarity would suffer, and that was affecting, you know, my daily life, because I had to snack all the time. So what I did was, when I started exploring intermittent fasting, I did a mini fast, then I moved into a 12-hour fast. And now I can go 16, 18 hours without food. And it's such a liberating feeling, because I don't have to carry my tiffins everywhere. You know what I mean? And that's one of the big benefits of fasting. You see, when you know that you're mentally sharp, And when you know that you don't have to carry your food around, and then you know that your body is running on ketones and it is deriving energy from your stored fats, mm-hmm. it's a win-win situation.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That is why it's become all the rage and all for all the right reasons. But unfortunately, the shortcuts is where the problem is. And if you allow me just a few more moments to talk about intermittent fasting, I say that the fasting format that you choose also has, your gender also has an impact on it. Because for females, for women, because you have the whole reproductive system and the hormones that are associated with that system, that you have to be slightly even more careful when you're doing fasting. So in my opinion, I'm more of a 16-8, which is the upper limit. And I usually prefer my clients, especially my female clients, to stick to the 16-8 format and not go beyond it.
Got it. So as a starting point, you think 16-8 is a starting point, or can you do 10-14?
Yeah, okay. So what happens is, what I do is I have a 7-stage process, and we complete those 7 phases in mm-hmm. 2 months. So what happens is every phase, one phase would be 1 week and the other phase would be maximum 2 weeks, mm-hmm. depending on how tough that particular phase is. So we start off with phase one, which is a simple 3+2 format, which is you're having 3 meals plus 2 snacks, and you're just aligning your nutrition. You're basically having all the good foods and you're just doing it for a week. The second phase begins when you cut out the snacks and you're doing mini fasts. So logically, it appeals to me that if you're going to prepare for a 16-hour of fasting, why not start with a mini fast and, tame and prime your metabolism? So you do that for a couple of weeks, and then you go into a 12-hour fast. Then you move into a 14-hour fast. Then you move into a 16-hour fast. And so when you're doing, when you're progressively and gradually building it up, then you don't feel it. Like you said in the beginning, if you would do a 20-hour fast right off the bat, you'd get overwhelmed.
That's right. No, I think it makes sense, and progressively kind of navigating your body, right? It's literally navigating yes. your body to reach the certain yes. level, and then kind of maintaining that level after that, yes. right?
Yes. Yeah. Yes. And also, if I may add, there are certain signs that we must also take into account. When you're doing fasting the right way, then there are certain signs that you do not ignore. For example, when you're fasting, you look at your energy levels while you're on fast. You look at your sleep cycle. Is it getting better or is it getting worse? Your mental clarity, your focus. How are you being able to carry on your activities of daily living? What about moods? What about your aggression? What about frustration? Now, these are all points. This is subjective information. So what happens is, let's say, Amita, you're at a 14-hour fast, right? And so we put these symptoms in front, and I ask you, how are you ranking on each of these symptoms? So if we see that you are, instead of getting better, they're getting worse, we cannot move forward. We need to take maybe a step back, or we need to, maybe add just one more week till your body is adapting to that particular format before we move forward. You see, when you take this approach, you're methodical, and you're also doing it the way that you're easing into it. It's not become a burden on you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
No, I think that makes sense. Well, to all the viewers, this is Intermittent Fasting 101. We just wanted to cover the basics today. And Adnan, anything else you'd like to say before we wrap up the session?
Well, I just want to say that, for a lot of people, intermittent fasting is a different, it's starvation or a calorie-based diet packaged differently. And nothing could be further from the truth, because at the end of the day, like I said in the beginning, fasting, you don't have to be fearing calories. In fact, it's quite the opposite. If you're having a one meal a day format, and if you've eased into it, then you're having about 2000 calories in just those 2 to 3 hours. So the concept also is, don't be afraid of food. worry about eating the right kinds of food and not cutting your calories indiscriminately.
Yes, rightly said. And then try, like you said, try the progression, right? The progression on your fasting, yes, rather than going, okay, I'm going to now do 1 meal a day or 24, which, and then it's going to go back again. So just go progressively to, yes, your point.
Yes.
Thank you so much, Adnan, for being with us. A very informational session, amazing session. I think you really clearly articulated, you know, how one should proceed if they are thinking of intermittent fasting. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.
Yes.